First of all, let us start with the KLIPPEL QC Start Engineer. This tool is dedicated to creating and managing test sequences, accessing the hardware configuration and calibration, and many more. So we have two access levels here. So the engineer has full access to all the options and settings while the operator rights are restricted. Before we start with creating a new test, usually we would have to set up our hardware. This has been done in advance. So we have a KLIPPEL Analyzer 3 connected. You can access the signal configuration and the sensor and amplifier calibration from the hardware menu. In order to create a new test, we can navigate to the test menu and click New. Now a dialog is opened that gives us access to all the available test sequence template. There are many various test sequences available here for transducers, passive and active, as well as wireless and digital, audio systems, headphones, components, and many more. So in our case, we have a woofer to be tested. So let's find the QC standard templates here for the transducers, and here is a woofer template. So that's a very general template which covers a certain resonance frequency and RE range. Our woofer is called woofer type XY. This is also the type ID that is found on the barcode of each device under test. All right, now ready to log in to the test sequence using the measure button. After logging in from QC Start Engineer, the DB Lab will open, which is the main framework software to operate the testing here. So we see a lot of different user interface elements. Let's close the property page first and let's check out the window elements. So first of all, we have our menu bar and the icon bar. We have the project window. In this case, it only contains one QC operation. We have the result window list, the operator control panel, which is the main panel for starting and running the test. And we have result windows, such as the summary window, which contains the pass-fail list later and the single value results, and our curve result windows for frequency response, distortion, and impedance in this case. Let's take a look at our property page, which is the most important dialog for the test setup. As you can see in the property page tasks, we can find our test sequence, which consists of a framework control task, one impedance measurement step, and the chirp-based sound pressure task for the acoustical response measurement. First of all, we need to take a look at the results that we want to get from our measurements. Let's take a look at the results category here. The sound pressure task is giving us several results such as frequency response, average level, polarity, THD, second and third harmonic, and rub and buzz. We can activate more, but at this point, this is sufficient. And for the impedance task, we have other results such as impedance magnitude and a complete list of telesmall parameters like RE, FS, QTS, and many more. Secondly, we should check our signal routing. This can be done in a central spot in the control start task in the routing category. So we know that our device under test is connected to the speaker output 1, and we have connected our test sensor microphone and the noise microphone to mic input 1 and 2. So this is correct. No changes need to be done here. Also, we want to control our serial number handling. We want the operator to input the serial number for each test. And by activating this option here, we get a new input window here in the control panel. And finally, we want to control the data logging. In the control finish task, we see that our text file-based summary log is already activated and also the full KLIPPEL results file. And additionally, we maybe want to save microphone signals in WAV files in order to pre-process the data at a later point of time, or in order to analyze the distortion in detail in a time frequency analysis, for example. Before we can run our first test, we need to check the stimulus voltage. So in the impedance step, we have a small signal test condition, so we need a relatively low voltage. We can maybe give the 200 millivolts here a start, and in the sound pressure task, we can use higher voltages because we want to drive the device under test in the large signal range. The voltage that we need to set here can be defined by the data sheet or maybe the R&D department, or we can figure out a good test level by stepping up the voltage until we have a certain amount of distortion, such as 10%. We already have a predefined value here, which is 3 volts for this unit. After having set up the voltage, we can do a first quick test run. Let's hit the start button. Now let us check the results. It seems like the routing was set up correctly. We have results that look reasonable in every result window. So we have our frequency response here, which is not too linear because we use an end-of-line test box. We have our impulsive distortion, aka Rubin bus, and we have harmonic distortion, the total harmonic distortion, second and third harmonic, and we have our impedance magnitude and the fitted impedance, which is base for the Taylor small parameters, which are displayed in the summary window over here. So we have results here for RE and FS and QTS. The fitting error indicates how well the model was fitted together with the real measurement. For the sound pressure task, we also have one single value result, which is the average level. So the quick setup guides basically ends here, but maybe we want to change some additional settings. First of all, we want to configure the control panel for the operator. We can do this here in control start configuration category. So we already have a few buttons here like start, repeating a test, logging out of the test, and the manual sweep for diagnostics. Maybe we want to add the right for the operator to calibrate the limits based on a golden unit. And since we want to use online statistics, a reset button is also very practical. Let us adjust the window size here in order to make all the buttons visible. We can store the window configuration with this icon. For the impedance step, we don't have to do any changes because this all looks pretty good. And for the sound pressure task, we can adjust some settings such as stimulus time because we want to speed up the measurement a bit. So let's just reduce our sweep time to 0.5 seconds. And in order to have still enough time resolution at low frequencies, we can activate our speed profile, which is available here. Above 1 kHz, the sweep speed is 5 times higher than below. And we can reduce this number to focus more on the low frequency part of our test. So let's reduce this to 500 Hz. Another nice feature is the normalized view of the frequency response, which helps you visualizing systematic differences to the golden unit or maybe the reference average pool. So let us normalize our response to the golden dot. This is something that we will see later as soon as we have defined some limits. As a last setting, there's a nice feature hidden in the hardware menu, which allows us to listen to the microphone signal inside the test box through headphones or any audio device connected to your PC. And we're mostly interested in the Rubin bus signal because the fundamental frequency response is masking most of the distortion. I will apply some gain because this signal is usually pretty low in terms of absolute level. And finally, we want to rearrange some windows here because I've actually activated the normalized frequency response, which is in a separate window. So let's rearrange here the impedance window, put the normalized response here. And now let's store this configuration. Well, let's do a final test run to verify our settings. Okay, this all looks fine. The frequency response and the normalized view is still empty because we have not defined the golden unit yet.